at AICT, and we welcome each one of you participants who have assembled with us today from the state of Andhra Pradesh, from AICT recognized institutes. And let me also first also introduce each one of you to our esteemed panelists. Our esteemed panelist for the day happens to be from Chitkara University. And as we are talking, I can also see Vice Chancellor Chitkara University, ma'am, Archana Mantri, ma'am, a warm welcome to you. Welcome, ma'am, and along with you. Thank you, ma'am. Thanks a lot. And it's always an honor that we have people of your eminence and caliber do joining in on our activities towards enabling the faculty members at whichever rank and service that they are in various AICT related initiatives. I would also like to introduce you to Dr. Jeevan. Dr. Jeevan, sir, you're there? He would be joining in also as part of the panelists in due course of time, because that collectively they would be taking you down over a period of Dr. Vijay Jadhan, sir, you're there? No issue. The Dean, Dr. Vijay Jadhan of Department of Civil and Mechatronics from Chitkara University would be joining in due course, and he would also be along with Archana Mantri, ma'am, be taking over this complete activity over a period of next 3 days, that is today, tomorrow and day after. A small brief and a rundown of AICT and why we do these activities for everybody. Number one, AICT has been continuously carrying out various quality initiatives with a single purpose, that these quality initiatives are meant for the overall improvement of the education as such. And when we talk of the education, in one of the various activities related, you call it curriculum revision, you call it training of teachers, you might call it mandatory internships, you might call it student induction program, you might call it scholarships, you might call it at the end, you can call it industrial connectivity, you can call hackathons, innovation, entrepreneurship, accreditation. All this happens to be one of the prime spoken activities in education sector. Each one of them has to be quantified, unless and until quantified, and quantified with certain benchmark, I do not think that any activity can be carried out. That quantification in English is called as examination. But when related to technical education as such, when you and me are connected, this examination is not that quantification. This examination is for assessing or judging your students to make them capable enough, number one, to earn livelihood, number two, to be in such a manner that they come out in contributing to the overall national growth. So to that extent, AICT in the year about 18-19 carried out examination reforms, and the policy of the examination reforms is available on the website of AICT. Each one of you are at liberty to go read it and get to know the highlights of this policy is that the policy is based on outcome-based education, is learner-centric, and is dependent on the Bloom's level of difficulty as to how the questions are to be framed and as to how should be the judgment and analysis of students done. So to that extent, we have requested Chitkara University, and Archana Mantri, ma'am, being the Vice Chancellor herself, was more than willing to come forward and spare her time to educate or bring out relevant information and points to various faculty members. And we are today, ma'am, for your information, we have already touched about 650 plus participants, this being a forum wherein the sensitization of the activity is being done. I would request you, ma'am, to, without wasting any further time, you can take over the stage. And on behalf of AICT, we once again welcome Chitkara University panelists. We welcome each and every participant who has joined in. Participants are requested to please keep into consideration, please keep connected for all 3 days. A certificate is issued by AICT of the participation at the end of 3 days based on your attendance. And on the third day, because we would be putting a Google form, that is tomorrow afternoon or evening, my office will take out a Google form for each one of you to put up your questions, and some of the questions would be discussed on the third day. basically just to align you as to how a particular question is to be framed. Thank you, ma'am. And I would request Archana Mantri, ma'am, that stage is all yours. You can continue with the activity, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Colonel Venkat. Thank you, AICT, for giving us this opportunity, because I am a firm believer that a teacher learns the most when he or she teaches. When I conduct a workshop, and that might be a similar experience for many of you who might be conducting workshops in your expertise area, you might agree with me that the workshop coordinator convener learns the most when he or she conducts the workshop. So that is why I thank you once again for giving us this opportunity, because this is also a learning opportunity for us, while we can share the knowledge, wisdom, and skills that we have with our fellow colleagues. Nowhere we are going to give in this workshop any prescription, but just an awareness, and I would say shake the minds of the fellow colleagues that they can appreciate what and why examination reforms are necessary. So as Colonel Venkat has already put up, this particular workshop is going to be conducted for next 3 days, every day from 10:30 to 2:15. And this is workshop on examination reforms. The session one, which I am going to conduct, is on context setting and need for examination reforms. And I am, as already introduced, Archana Mantri, Vice Chancellor, Chitkara University. So the objective of this workshop is to walk through the stepwise procedure proposed in the policy document, which is available on the AICT website. And the basic aim is to improve the quality of assessments to produce employable professionals, which are self-enablers. The outcome, that means what the participants will be able to learn at the end of this workshop, will be that they will be able to design assessments. You all, 778 participants that I can see here, are going to design assessments at all levels of Bloom's taxonomy. At least you will try your hands on. If not, a lot of practice, that is certainly not possible. To assess attainment of program outcomes based on principles of outcome-based education of Washington Accord. And finally, you will be able to map questions, course outcomes, Bloom's taxonomy levels, and performance indicators for the examinations or the tests that you design. These are the outcomes. And with this objective, we proceed forward. And at this point, I just want to take a moment to understand the demography of the 800 plus odd participants that we have here. I will ask my poll coordinator to launch the poll at this moment of time. You all will be given 30 seconds to respond to this question. Shivani ma'am, can you please launch the poll at the screen? Kindly click if you are a teacher from Polytechnic College or if you are a teacher from an engineering college. As a workshop coordinator, it's very important for me to understand the demography of the participants in this particular workshop. The poll has ended, and we are going to show you the results. Can we show the results, Shivani ma'am? All right, so we have almost 190, only close to 200 people have responded. And out of the 200 people who have responded, 195 are from engineering college and 7 are from Polytechnic College. That itself gives me an idea that almost 98% of the people are from engineering college here. Nevertheless, we go on to the next question. Another poll, and I want to understand Can you please launch the next poll question, Shivani ma'am? Out of the words OBE, Bloom's taxonomy, program outcomes, graduate attributes, how many words have you heard before? You will have to respond to one of the answers. None of them, one of them, two of them, three of them, all of them. Are you launching the next poll, Shivani ma'am? Already done? I cannot see the poll being launched here. Nevertheless, on the screen, I'm still seeing the old poll. Anyway, I think the people are writing in the chat window. Poll is still not visible. That's what the people are saying. Anyway, many of you have written in the chat window that many of you have heard all the words before, which means Bloom's taxonomy, program outcomes, graduate attributes. Many of you have heard these words before, but quite a few of you are also saying two of them, three of them also you are saying. Now the poll is launched. If you can take 15 seconds to please respond on the poll. Now the poll is visible to you. Kindly respond if you have heard all the words or a few of them. Kindly respond to the poll. It's showing the poll has ended. All right, there must be some technical glitch. Can you please make ready the next poll? That's the final poll that we have to understand your level of knowledge about the topics, the content that are going to be covered in this workshop, and then we proceed from there on. Can you please launch the next poll? Poll question three, if you can launch it. Now I want you to respond to the next poll. Has it been launched? I can still not see it. Probably it is coming up, and I want you to respond if you want to, if you have come to this workshop to earn a certificate, because the poster says so that e-certificates will be issued. Your college management wants you to attend this workshop, or if you think that the examination reforms are necessary, or you think that you want to learn how the traditional examination system can be reformed for better. I want you to respond to the most important reason. Many of you are responding with fourth option, which means that you want to learn how the traditional examination system can be reformed for better. I know that all the first three are also important for you, but the fourth one, many of you are saying that it is important. That establishes the need for this workshop, because all of you want to know that traditional examination systems should be and can be reformed for better, and you all want to learn from that. So let's now come to the outline and schedule for this 3-day workshop. Day one is context setting, which is welcome address has already been delivered by Colonel Venkat. We are in session one, wherein I am setting the context. Then there will be session two, wherein outcome-based education will be talked about, and you all will be deliberating upon graduate attributes, competencies, performance indicators. Day two will be devoted to Bloom's taxonomy and how to design questions using Bloom's taxonomy, and then how rubrics are important for assessment of professional outcomes, and how you can do a complete assessment planning for your course. These are the two things which will be discussed tomorrow. At the end of day one, that is today, and also day two, there will be an assignment given to all of you. And on day three, we are going to discuss some sample question papers which the participants will be bringing to the workshop, and we will be commenting and deliberating upon the suitability of those question papers for the outcomes or measurement of the course learning outcomes or program outcomes, how they are suitable for assessing those outcomes, and also knowledge and skill levels for the students. And finally, concluding remarks. So this is the whole layout for the 3 days workshop that we have. You can close the poll, Shivani ma'am. It's not required anymore. So let's come to session one. In this particular session, what are you going to learn? And or putting it otherwise, at the end of this session, you will be able to list the reasons why reforms in examinations are important. You are going to recall common mistakes in designing assessments and align with different approaches, motivation that people take to design and perform the assessments. It is not important how and what content is being packed in this workshop. It is important how you guys, you people, the participants of this workshop, and how much you are able to learn. So kindly keep a note of these outcomes, and at the end of this session, you will be able to do all this. We are going to do a quick check at the end of this session also. The ground rules, you will have to keep your cameras and mic off. Probably it is also you will not be allowed to turn on your camera and mic. When prompted, you have to respond to the polls. And whenever I'm going to ask you a question during the session, and if I ask you to write your responses in the chat window, please do so. There will be assignments at the end of day one and day two, and I want all of you to be completing those assignments and upload it at a portal which will be subsequently told. Let's talk about this learner's triangle. There is a picture here. Many of you might have seen this already, but I still want you to have a look at it and write in the chat window your interpretation of the picture that you see here. You are allowed 1 minute of time, and your interpretation of this picture, which is the learner's triangle. Keep on writing in the chat window, what is your interpretation? Come on, your responses. Keep on writing whatever comes to your mind looking at this picture. Keep on writing. It's very important for us as teachers to understand the learning process. Keep on writing. I've received about 10 responses so far. Keep on writing. Yeah, the time is ending. As many of you can respond, keep on doing. Great, we have a very responsive audience here. I'm so happy that you are all interacting in this workshop. This is good. All right, stop please. Many of you have responded that this, some of you are saying that it is the process. Some of you are saying that it is learning centric. quite a few of you are saying that it is the interconnectivity of learning objectives, instruction and assessment. Few of you are saying that students are at the center, student-centric processes. Great. I think many of you have given a complete right interpretation of this picture. But for the purpose of completion, let me tell you my interpretation of this picture. This particular picture says that in the learning process and in design of learning experiences, as teachers, we are designers. Don't you agree with me? We are all designers of learning experiences for our students, which means that the whole process of teaching learning keeps students at the center, which incidentally, many of you respondents have already written in the chat window. But mind you, that this particular picture is not a flowchart. It's not one process or one end of the, or maybe one element of the learning process coming after the other. This is clearly a triangle wherein all the three vertices of the triangle are co-placed. They are all in the same plane, not coming one after the other. Also, you will find that there is a double-sided arrow which is connecting the three vertices of the triangle. There is a learning objective, then there is an instruction, and there is an assessment. You will see that in this picture, none of the three processes can be thought and designed in isolation. That is also very clearly visible in this picture. It says that if you are thinking of assessments, you need to co-think about learning objectives and instruction. If you are designing instruction, or as we call the pedagogy, you need to keep in mind, co-think at learning object of learning objectives and assessments also. And if you are designing your learning objectives, you also need to think about your instructions and assessment. But the question is, do we do this way? Probably not. When we are thinking of learning objectives, most of us do not think about how we are going to teach those so that our students achieve those learning objectives. How are we going to assist them? Probably the kind of instructional design approach that most of us follow is choose a text, we think, or we choose a particular textbook and think of the topics that we are going to teach. Then we think, what are the chapters to be covered? We develop lectures, we prepare our lectures, and then finally, when the time of examination, quizzes or homework comes in, we design that exam, homework or quiz at that time, just maybe one day prior, and throw it to the students to attempt. Most of you would agree to it. Even if we consciously think that learner's triangle is the basis of the whole education theory, we still follow a one after the other approach to develop the whole or design the whole learning experiences for our students. And this design is backward, which means it is not appropriate. Backward word, you would understand, is a very old thought, old school of thought of designing the learning experiences for our students. What should be done instead is this. We should first think of the learning goals for our students. What is it that I want my students to know, understand, and be able to do? Most of you might have already connected it to a similar statement. What is this knowledge and skill that I want my students to attain at the end of this course? This is the first question which should come to your mind. The second question that should come to your mind is, how will I know as an instructor that these learning goals which I have designed for my students will be met? How will I know? That means the assessments need to be thought immediately or probably almost at the same time that we are designing our learning objectives or learning goals. I think you would all agree with me. Next is, or probably at the same time, we need to think what activities, what content, what is it that my students will be able to do that they have enough engagement in order to achieve those learning goals. So nowhere we are thinking of the content specifically as of now. We are thinking of what is it that my students would achieve at the end of this course, what knowledge and skill they would develop. Next is how, what are my parameters, performance indicators as we call it, that I will be able to assess my students that these learning objectives have been achieved. What activities will engage a diverse group of students? So engagement is very, very important. You would appreciate in the next 3 days and the resource persons who are I and Dr. Jadhav, when we are going to discuss, we will make you appreciate that it is not important how much we are able to teach them. What is important is how much they are able to learn and how much they are able to showcase their learning on the performance indicators that we have decided for them. And finally, is there an alignment between goals, assessment, and activities? So content is, in a subtle manner, as a backbone of this whole learning experiences design exercise that we as a teachers need to do. First of all, bring in your minds a disruptive thought that we are not designing or we are not preparing our lectures. We are preparing or designing their learning experiences. And follow this process. And this approach is known as designing backwards. So the other one, the first one was backward design, which means an old school of thought which doesn't work now. But this design is the right design, but it asks you to think of the outcome first and then designing backwards for learning goals, for assessments, for implementation, and the alignment. You would appreciate again that the learner's triangle says the same thing. Think of the three things, that is the instruction, the learning objective, and the assessment together. Keep students at the center. That is what is the whole philosophy of outcome-based education also. We'll talk about outcome-based education in more detail in the next session, but this is what is the whole idea and the difference between backward design and designing backwards. And I would recap, re-emphasize that designing backwards, thinking of outcome first, is the right approach rather than taking a content first approach and then designing everything else, which is a backward design approach. The difference of the letter S makes it all happen. Let's deliberate further and send our minds tickling a little bit more. Since this particular workshop is on the examination reforms, we are going to talk a lot about assessments. So let's talk about, as engineers, what, why, how, and when. As engineers, we have always been trained to talk about these four parameters, these four key questions for any problem at hand. And when we are talking of examination reforms, we need to think, deliberate, question ourselves on what, why, how, and when. What I'm going to show you are some pictures. I'll keep silent, and I want you to look at the pictures and interpret them on your own. You need not to write anything on the chat window. Just look and think. The first question, how am I testing? Keep your thoughts to yourselves, deliberate, think in your mind. Who am I testing? So the first question, how am I testing? The second, who am I testing? Why am I testing? I am teaching. Are they learning? What is more important for you? Their learning or your teaching? What am I testing? And finally, do some things ever change? Look at this. I'm sure you must have interpreted these cartoons, pictures, whatever you can call it, in your own way. I'll take this opportunity to go back to the four questions and recap. How am I testing? Who am I testing? Why am I testing? What am I testing? And do some things ever change? Once you have seen this, I want you to read a document which I am going to flash on the screen now. Keep a moment to go through, scroll through this document, and then we will deliberate something more on the chat window. That is what will be an activity for you. So I'm sharing now the document. That I want you to read on your screen. You can zoom in, zoom out using the buttons on the left side of the screen. You will find two lenses there, and you can zoom in and zoom out. I'll give you a minute or maybe 3 minutes to read this document, and then we will deliberate a little bit on this document. In the chat window also, there is a link where you can download this document also if you are not able to see it on the screen. In the chat window, we have shared the link of this document. You can download it from there also, else you can read it over there. About 30 seconds left more for you to finish reading this document. And then I'll ask you to write something in the chat window based on the prompts. Please write it. Clearly, this reading shows you two conversations, one amongst the students, which you can hear in your own college campus corridors many a times. And the second set of conversation is between group of professors, which you can overhear in the staff rooms many a times. These are all common conversations that we hear all day long in our campuses. So once you have finished reading, 10 seconds more and I'll stop sharing. Now, what I want you to do is, I want you to write in the chat window first one reason why the students are complaining. First of all, you have to write in the chat window, in your opinion, one reason why you think that the students are complaining about an upcoming test. You all have gone through the reading. And then in the chat window, you need to write at least one reason why it is important that you should assess your students. and we'll discuss it. I'll tell you my interpretation also. I'm looking at what you are typing in the chat window. That means many of you have read the document which was shared, and many of you are writing the reasons why there is a complaint on the student side and why there is a complaint on the professor side. And you need to write now, why should, in your opinion, why do you assess your students? You as a teacher, why do you assess your students? Okay, so stop writing now in the chat window. You have clearly seen in the document that was shared that there is a communication gap between the professors and the students. The professors are doing their bit on one hand, students are doing their bit on the other side. One of the students is saying there is a 600 pages textbook, and Professor Gupta wants us to know everything which is written there. On the contrary, Professor Gupta is saying that if you give them straight from the books the questions, they are going to do it. But if at all you tweak a question a little bit, they are not going to answer. So they are complaining the professors that the students are not ready to learn. And the students are saying that there is an unnecessary expectation from the professors to know so much that is not humanly possible for the students to learn. Clearly, the objectives which should have been shared right at the beginning as an expectation from the course, from the assessment, has not been shared by the professors. Similarly, the students, if at all shared, the students do not know about it. So clearing expectations is very important when you are assessing or designing your assessments for the students. Also, it is important for us, all of us know that assessments are important. But why are they important? That is what is something that is to be deliberated, to be thought about. Are we going to assess the students on the content that we have taught to them? Or are we going to assess our students on the requisite knowledge and skill that the students should have gained? There is a difference. The first reason is content-centric. The second reason is student-centric. So once you decide and once you know that it is important for you to assess your students for the knowledge and skill that they should possess, you are going to teach it. What you are going to teach? The requisite knowledge and skill that the student should have achieved. In the first case, you are just teaching the content topics, that's all. That is the difference between why it is important. Establishing why in your own minds as designers of learning experiences and the assessments is very important. So one thing is clear from this reading, that making expectations clear to the students. Secondly, what is the objective of the course, the learning objectives as we call it, and the assessments, they should match. What is being important, what is important for the students to learn, that should be assessed. Not what you have taught and what is good to assess that you are assessing. All right, we'll move forward and come back to this point a little later. But some random thoughts on assessment I have put in. And I want you to read the second point first and the first point later. The second point says that examinations are formidable even to the best prepared, and you must have realized it in the reading that I shared just now with you. For the greatest fool may ask more than what the wisest man can answer. So, examinations as a tool, if you look at, you can use that tool to fail the student or pass the students. That's a different matter. Because even if I am not an expert in a particular area, I can still prepare a question paper which even the wisest or a expert in that field will not be able to answer. You would all agree with me. You have been teaching, many of you have been teaching for years. The first point says that assessment is the process of gathering evidence of students' learning to inform instructional decisions. Usually we do it reverse. We teach them and then we assess them. But a feedback path is usually missing, and that is what is that what the students should learn and what they actually learn. These two things should inform, and our instructional decisions should be drawn from that evidence. I'll repeat the sentence. What our students should learn and what they actually learn. They should learn, and what they actually learn should inform our instructional decisions. So these two things, these two statements are very important for you to change your mind on the assessments. Usually, when we are talking of examination reforms, our thought process is limited to making a good test. What can be termed as a good test? Very complicated questions, a question paper which fails most of the students, and we think that we have made a very good question paper. Some more thoughts I'll put in front of you. Assessments drives learning. And if knowledge and skills are important, you need to assess them. The second, many of you have written in the chat window, making expectations clear. How can we increase the chances of students finding a particular learning material interesting is solely that the assessment that we are going to take is going to be a performance indication of the knowledge and skill that they have attained or they have incorporated, they have been able to gain. So make assessment a tool that drives the learning, not only to grade, pass or fail the students. You must write and share the learning objectives before you assess them. And you have to tell them that these learning objectives are important for you. You must attain these learning knowledge and skills at the end of the session, and I am going to assess you on this, not from that 600 pages book that is in your hands. Out of that 600 pages book, what are those knowledge and skills that is important for you as students to learn? You have to make that expectation, those objectives clear to your students. A book is only content. A book is only chapters. A book is only syllabus. If they have to learn everything from that book, why are they in your class? If there is so much now in the era of information technology available on their screens, why are they in your class? Ask this question to yourself. Are they in your class only for attendance? If the answer is yes, you are not doing your bit as a teacher. So assessments, bottom line is, assessments, if they are performance indicators of the right set of knowledge and skill that you as teacher are imparting to them, then assessments are going to drive the learning. So three things: clear expectations, design assessments to measure learning, not your teaching. Design appropriate instructions for their learning, not your teaching. And then your assessments become the central figure of the whole learning experience that you are designing for them. That is what is the importance of assessments. Two principles on assessments: the content principle and the learning principle. So assessments should reflect the content that is most important for the students to learn. That doesn't mean that you give them a question bank saying that these are the important questions that you learn and you will pass my exam. So when you are asking your students to learn and assess, and you make your assessments to assess those important knowledge and skill, you are bound to teach it. You would all agree with me. The learning principle says, on the contrary, that assessment should enhance learning and support good instructional practice. Remember, in the first statement here, it is said that it is the process of gathering evidence of student learning to inform instructional decisions. How many of us make or design our instructions so that the student's performance in the assessments improve? My question is very pertinent and important. And how many of us design assessments to measure the knowledge and skill of the students that is very important for them to attain at the end of this course? And hence the content principle, and hence the learning principle. You would agree that they are hand in hand. And how can you think one without the other? So learning objectives, instructional design, and assessments, all these three things should continuously be together in your mind, not one after the other. These are some of the random thoughts on assessment that you should put, and some jargon on assessment and evaluation, which I'm sure many of you might know, and there are equal chances that you might not. We usually use assessment and evaluation quite interchangeably. But assessment, apart from other definitions that you will find in the literature, assessments are actually identifying the data that will be collected to measure knowledge, skill, attitude, and learning. And then selecting and creating an instrument that we call as a test instrument that will be used to gather that data. And administering the process itself also is a part of the whole word assessment. So assessment is a noun as well as a verb. You identify the data. Again, when you will talk, we will be talking about performance indicators a little later during this workshop. We are going to design these assessments, which essentially is a tool, is an instrument that is used to gather the data to find the evidence of learning. Evaluation, on the other hand, is the data which has been collected using assessment and drawing conclusions from the results is evaluation. And the analyzed data, which is in front of us, in form of evaluation, it can be used to improve the quality of the student's learning and also instructional teaching. And when you do this, when you use this data, this results by analyzing the data midway during the whole process of learning, and you modify your instructional design to improve students' learning, it becomes formative assessment, because you still have some chances of improving students' performance, students' learning, and you can modify your instructional design or the instructions that you impart in the class to improve their learning. Nowhere I am saying content. The word content somehow has taken a back seat. And that is what is a formative assessment. And when you, at the end of the whole thing, you assign grades or make pass or fail decisions, then it becomes a summative assessment. That is what is the difference between formative, summative, assessment, evaluation. Apart from other definitions, I'm not saying that is the only definition and interpretation of assessment and evaluation, but one of them. And finally, there is an example there that when the cook tastes the soup, when a cook is making the soup, and intermittently he tastes the soup, whether the salt is right, the spices are right, the ingredients are right, he can still add one or two things more. That's the formative assessment. But when the cook serves the soup to the guests, and the guests make a decision, oh, the soup is not nice, the soup is very tasty, then that's a summative assessment. Nothing can happen beyond that. That's the power of formative assessment in the hands of the instructor to make learning experiences better. So these are some of the jargon, some of the thoughts, some of the mind-shaking questions that are in front of you, and how much you can do with the assessments to make the learning experiences of your students better. You must all think, go back and think on these tools, and how many of us thought that assessments are only to make those decisions whether our students are doing good or bad. Powerful tools in our hands. So at this point of time, can we have the poll question launched? How many of you think most common pitfall? All of them are pitfalls, but most common pitfall in the traditional examination systems, based on the discussion that we have just had, that the tests are made only to assess the content, they are poorly designed, the expectations from the students are not clear, and the objectives of the tests are not clear to the teachers and to the students, both. In your opinion, what is the most important or most common pitfall in the traditional examination system? 30 seconds, I think 1 minute. 1 minute time is given to you. Think clearly, think consciously. What do you think is the most common pitfall? Okay, the poll has ended. Please share the results. Okay, so here the mandate is divided. 185 of the participants think that the objectives of the tests are not clear to the teachers and to the students. 61 of you say that the expectations from the students are not clear. 63 of you say that the tests are poorly designed. And 75 of you say that the tests are made to assess only the content. Mind it, whatever be the reason, the students are solely not responsible for bad performance. Do you all agree? Looking at your responses, at least I think it now this way. That it is the sole responsibility of students not performing good in the exams. At least there are four other reasons which you have given yourself that the students are not able to perform. Which means there is a whole lot of opportunity for us as teachers to eliminate the four of these reasons that our students are not able to perform. That our assessments, 63 of you at least have said so, out of the close to 300 respondents, 941, 300 have responded, and close to 61 of you say that the tests are not, are made only to assess the content. Should we do something about it? Who is going to do? We are going to do something about it. Close to 70 of you say that the tests are poorly designed. I am not saying this. You are saying this. So if the tests are poorly designed, we have a scope of improvement. Hence the reforms. If the expectations from the students are not clear, again, close to 75 of you say that. Who is to do something? We have to do something about it. So there is a scope of improvement. There is a need for reform. And if 185 of you say that the objectives of the tests are not clear to the teachers and to the students, who is going to make those objectives clear to the students? Teachers. That means we have a scope of improvement. That is the need of reforms. So we have well established by now that examination reforms is something that is the need of the hour, and who is going to do those reforms? We as teachers are going to bring in those reforms. Unless we are convinced as teachers, unless this 1,000 odd community present here are convinced that the reforms are necessary, they are not going to come by, no matter how many workshops and policies are made or designed and conducted by AICT, UGC, or anybody else. So if 350 of you are convinced that the reforms are necessary, at least 350 of us are going to do it. Let's eliminate these four reasons. Some more, in a nutshell, I have put here. Top three reasons for poor evaluations. Mind it, these are not research things, but experience and speculation and surveys on done on various teachers have done this. One of the surveys we have just now conducted a minute back on the poll, and 350 of you say that there are at least four reasons for students to perform not so good in their assessments. So bad tests, bad assignments, bad attitude. In the reading that was shared just now with you, the professor's attitude towards their students is not so good. They're all blaming them. So first is build that trust, bring that trust. The students have taken up engineering and come up to your college to gain knowledge. And if you do not have an empathetic, I'm not saying sympathetic, but empathetic attitude towards them, they're not going to learn. You will also come to know in the graduate attributes, when they will be discussed in the subsequent sections, that many of, in fact, a large chunk of the graduate attributes are built to build the attitude, right attitude, the positive attitude amongst your students. Who is building that attitude amongst the students? We, the teachers. So unless we have the right attitude, our students are not going to inculcate or build the right attitude. So eliminate all the above reasons before you blame the students for poor performance. Do not make bad tests too long, too tricky, unexpected material, poorly defined, too long, too much busy work. Don't be sarcastic to your students. Do not use discriminatory behavior or discriminatory language. Do not be unhelpful. You have to be available. You have to be helpful to your students. Your students come with different abilities, background, motivation to come engineering, to study engineering. But you should be helpful, available to them. Well, this point of time, we are going to read another document and I'm going to share it on your screen. Read it carefully and then we'll move into another deliberation. I'll just share it. Here is another reading. I've also shared the link in the chat window from where you can download this reading and also read it on your screens. This reading is about three students, Rohan, Rinku, and Ria. Read it carefully, and I'm going to prompt you on the characteristics of these students. We are trying to know our learners. So there are 3 minutes, 4 minutes given to you for this reading. Read it carefully. You can alternatively, you can download it from the link on the chat window and read it there. 4 minutes given to you. Two minutes more. 30 seconds. Okay, now I'm stopping to share and we'll go back to the prompt that I want you to write in the chat window. So do you think that Rohan, Riya and Rinku are three typical students present in your class? By looking at what they have to say about the course content or whatever course they are going through. So if you think yes, then please write in the chat window one characteristic each for each one of them. One characteristic for Rohan, one for Riya, and one for Rinku. These are the three types of students that are present in your class. We are trying to know the learners that we are going to assess for their learning. So write in the chat window, one characteristic for Rinku, one for Riya, one for Rohan. Yes, keep coming. I think you're all right when you are writing about the characteristics for each one of them. Keep coming, 30 seconds more. Is it okay now? All right, sorry, I was mute at one point of time. So I'll repeat what I said in the last minute, that there are always three kinds of students present in your class: Rohan, Riya, and Rinku. And over the years, you have found that these types of students will always be present. So as a teacher, what you can do? As a teacher, you can establish the relevance of the course content to these different kinds of students' interests and goals. You cannot always be teaching and preparing your teaching material only for Rohans, only for Riyas, and only for Rinkus. Similarly, you cannot always design all your assessments for one type of students. That is either only for Rohans, only for Riyas, only for Rinkus. The other very important thing is that you have to clearly state high level objectives. What are those high level objectives? How to define them will come subsequently to the in the next sessions. But at this point, it is important for you to know that high level objectives should be very clearly stated in the very beginning during the course, and they should be made clear to the students. And you have to conduct assessments to address them. If on one hand you state high level objectives but do not conduct your assessments, do not teach those high level objectives in your class, your job is not done. On the other hand, you conduct your assessments to assess those high level objectives, but your high level objectives are never stated, never reinforced, never recapitulated in your class, then also you are not doing your bit. So stating clear expectations, reinforcing them during the class, during the whole course of the semester, whenever you are teaching your courses, and designing your assessments, having those performance indicators inbuilt, that those high level objectives are measured using your tests, then only your complete design of curriculum is coherent. Remember, in the design backwards, we have talked about the fourth element, which is the coherency of instruction, objective, and assessments. If you are only teaching in your class definitions and derivations and assessing your students on the same always, wherein you tell them this is the formula, you fit those parameters and you will get an answer, your students' minds will be trained only to do that. But if you motivate, encourage, and engage your students in thinking, in creation, and you make your assessments to test creation, to test design, to test application, then they will be motivated and engaged to do that. So it is for you to design your assessments to test high-level objectives. And it is for you to establish the relevance of the course to the students' interests and goals. So on one hand, there will always be mixed set of people, Rohans, Riyas, and Rinkus in your class. It is in your hands to establish the relevance of the course content to students' interests and goals. And it is in your hands to clearly state the high-level objectives and conduct assessment to address them. That's the different approaches that you should take to take care of the diverse set of students present in your class. I have put a statement over here, and I want you to think and type in the chat window if you agree that we put in a lot of efforts to design a very beautiful course handout or course document, which has, you know, high level learning objectives. And, you know, we take cue from very many so-called advanced universities, grade A universities, and we bring out and prepare a beautiful document so far as course handouts and learning objectives are concerned. When it comes to instruction, we bring in newer pedagogy, active learning techniques, collaborative learning, experiential learning. We bring in newer social media material into our classes. We use latest ICT technologies to bring in the class. We do all that to take care of these two vertices, the learning objective and the instruction. But when it comes to assessment, we just pick questions from here and there, sometimes end of the chapter book questions, sometimes questions from the internet, and we use it just as formalities to grade our students. But remember, assessments drive learning. Unless you can make your assessments reflect the objectives and instruction, you will not be able to engage the students in the class. I'll repeat, if you are showing or you are designing assessments only as formalities, then your students will not be engaged in the class. If you are designing very, I would say, carefully and precariously your assessments to reflect the right proper set of learning objectives that you have designed in your course material, in your course handout, and if you are designing instructions to address them, and if you are also designing your assessments to reflect the other two, then you are bang on. But if you agree with the right side statement just on your own, you need not to judge anybody else. Think of yourself. Think of your own teaching. If you are doing this, stop doing it. Examination reforms. Bring in reforms into your assessments, into the designing of your assessments, and stop blaming your students. That is what is the need for examinations. A final comment, then we'll move into some questions and I'll end the session there for you to think and answer those questions. A test is much more than just grading the students and just a means of taking feedback on your learning or on your teaching. It is much more than that. We have just now discussed what all the test or a right assessment instrument can do to the whole learning experience for your students. The objective of the test should be very important to test what the students ought to know and not what the students may not know. What the students ought to know and what the students may not know or do not know. And to supplement the students' knowledge and motivate them to come to class. I always say, and always ask this question to yourself, observe this. When your students take your sessional test or your entrance test, do they come out of the examination hall and tear that paper and throw it away? Or keep it as a document for them to aid the material that they have collected all through the semester for their learning? The tool, the assessment tool itself, the assessment of the test or the examination paper itself should add or aid to the student's knowledge body. And it should motivate them to come to class. They should be the simple act of retaining that paper, examination paper that you have made, will say 1,000 words. Whether that assessment instrument or examination paper was relevant to them or not. And finally, as I said, I will leave you with some questions. The question you should ask yourself before designing an assessment is, we have started with four set of questions. What, why, how, and when, and who? The same is getting repeated here. What is being assessed? Content or knowledge and skill gained by the student? What the student should know, ought to know, rather than what he or she should not know or may not know. So is it content specific, the test, or it is knowledge and skill specific? What is the purpose of assessment? To test what they ought to know and what they do not know. What is it that you want to assess? Who will do the assessment? Are you as teacher doing the assessment? There is a concept of peer assessment also, where the students evaluate themselves, their peers. Self-assessment is also a prodigy these days. It's a habit, it's a practice these days. Self-assessment is a very good benchmarking process in many international universities. Industry or a jury, who will do the assessment? And the assessment, then instrument should be designed accordingly. Which method is to be used? Case study, written exams, oral exams, open book exam, seminar, project work, mini project, quiz, what is it? When is the assessment is being conducted? In class, midterm, end term, internship, formative, summative, what is the kind of assessment that you are doing? And finally, how you are going to feed it back to the students? Because remember, assessments give a very important feedback on the instructional design also. So all these are important. So we come to the close of this session, and I had promised that at the end of this session, the participants, you, will be able to list the reasons why reforms in examinations are important, recall common mistakes in designing the assessments, and align with different approaches, motivation that people take to design and perform in the assessments. And your answers and my answers are these. These are the three most important reasons why reforms are necessary. Traditional examinations carry least priority in the curricular domains and are left as last things to do. Just not the instruments to pass or fail or grade the students, but they are much more than that. Usually they test the content, the syllabus, the topics, not the knowledge and skills gained by the students. And they do not motivate the students to learn and are just used, being used as means to grade the students. That too, not properly designed. The objectives are not clear. Hence the reforms. Let us recall some common mistakes. Sometimes the tests are too complicated or difficult, or they are too easy or low level to test higher level learning objectives. So if you are not designing your test instruments to test higher learning objectives, your students are never going to learn. They test what the students may not know rather than what the students ought to know. So these are some of the common design assessments mistakes, and how you can align different approaches, motivations to prepare and for your students to perform. They should be designed to test higher level objectives in the courses. And they should be designed to test all kinds of students. Remember Rohan, Riya, and Rohan. And finally, those test instruments should take care of the intrinsic and extrinsic motivation. Because remember, Rohans are important. Rohans are always interested intrinsically to learn. And remember, Riyas and Rinkus would always require extrinsic motivation to perform in the exams and to learn. So here is the summary. Here is the outcome. There may be many more thoughts in your minds based on the readings, based on the deliberations that we have done. Keep those deliberations, keep your thoughts, keep your questions in the mind. And as you move through in this workshop, keep on answering these questions. Because the need is there in your minds. You have said it by the survey instrument that we have just administered, that there is an important requirement for reforms in the examinations. With those words, we come to the end of the session. There is going to be a 15 minutes break, and after that we'll resume for the second session. On the same link, you can join back or you can keep it on hold, take a short break and come back at 12:15 precisely. We are going to start with the next session. Thank you very much. Have a good day.
म्यूट है कि नहीं है, पता नहीं दिखेंगे ये म्यूट है कि नहीं से पता लगेगा। म्यूट का बटन क्यों है यानी
बोर्ड नहीं सर बोर्ड आई सर सर बहुत बहुत ऐड करें
Welcome all the participants. I suppose all of you have must have joined again for this session. And I am thankful to our Vice Chancellor, Professor Archana Mantri, who has given this first session and set the stage for me to discuss about the outcome-based education framework. And I'm sure now you all are aware of, and you are basically, you are in line with that this education, this examination reforms are very much essential. And the design of assessment is also very, very essential in our education experience. So the flow of this particular session would be the outcome-based education framework. We'll be discussing outcome-based education framework. And some of the key aspects of outcome-based education was already being discussed while Professor Mantri has deliberated upon all three basic pillars of education, that is the curriculum, teaching learning process, and assessment. All these pillars have been discussed, and with a lot of examples and your readings and polls, I am sure that you must have participated and enjoyed and must have learned many new things out of that discussion. So the outcome-based education, what exactly we have in this outcome-based education is we are shifting our focus from teacher-centric approach to learner-centric approach. What does it mean that we are shifting our focus from teacher-centric approach to student-centric approach or learner-centric approach? That is also quite, you can say, brilliantly touched upon by Professor Mantri as well. We focus on what students should learn and to what extent he has learned. So there are two important aspects of learning in outcome-based education, and we start from that. Basically, it is a approach where we come from top to the bottom, and at the top we put all you can say learn what learner should know, and at the same time to what extent he has learned. So that is what basic philosophy of this outcome-based education is, and we'll be deliberating on this outcome-based education framework in detail in this particular session. And the learning, how to measure the extent of the learning ability of the student, that basically is only possible if we have set of parameters that we have listed, and then only on those parameters should be measurable also, then only we'll be able to measure the level of attainment of what exactly they have learned, that then only we'll be able to do that. So in outcome-based education, the another important thing is all teaching learning activities in higher education institution should be planned and conducted to facilitate the student to attain a well-defined and measurable outcome. So I'm sure that during poll also, I could very well see that most of you all are aware of these terms very well, this outcome regarding outcome-based education. Though outcome-based education framework, a learner is exposed to acquire higher order cognitive skill, and that is required for critical thinking, creativity, and problem solving. That is what our primary role is as engineer. So that is facilitated by outcome-based education, that we can inculcate these three very, very important you can say aspect, that is critical thinking, creativity, and problem solving and engineer through outcome-based education. And the next thing that we'll be discussing about the graduate attributes, that is the term that is internationally accepted. And we, in Indian context, we use the program outcome or program learning outcome. So if during this session, if we use the term graduate attributes or program outcome or program learning outcome, they will be considered interchangeably and they will be considered synonym to each other, because each of these terms are nothing. They are set of statement which are measurable and that we use for measuring the attainment of the learner. So that we'll be discussing after introducing outcome based education framework to you. Then in any case, as we have discussed it during in this outcome based education, we have to measure the ability or measure the outcome of the student. So that is the graduate attribute or the program outcome there at the top level. And we need to identify number of other activities and at the bottom level of this from top to bottom at the different levels. And in each and activity, we measure some outcome, and that we'll be discussing in the later stage of this session. And all those activities are to be mapped with the program of outcome or the graduate attributes. And it means we have to have a proper connection between the course outcome, that is the lower level. At lower level, we have the outcome defined for different activities, and then the program outcome or the program learning outcome or graduate attributes. So when we start mapping these two things to finally obtain how much student has learned and what are the, you can say, attribute he has acquired during the 4-year program, so we find that there is a mismatch, and it is quite difficult to very easily understood that a person very easily understand what how exactly is to be mapped. And that basically gives the wrong impression, because if we are not able to map the things properly, then it will give us wrong impression or wrong calculation of the outcome, and then it means our goal is not achieved that we have to achieve, we are supposed to achieve through the implementation of outcome based education framework. So that is what basically we will be discussing in this session. And the outcome based education as such is all about setting some goal or outcome and some objective. So that is why we have to first basically set objective and outcome for this particular session as well. And then we'll be starting our discussion. And I'm sure that most of us are already aware of what is the objective and outcome. The objective is basically that is what was used in the traditional educational system, when it was the teacher who was at the center and everything was upon the teacher, that how he has to set his goal to deliver whatever is supposed to deliver. So it means the objective is for me as presenter, and outcome is basically the collective teaching learning process, that what I am supposed to deliver and you are supposed to attain. So this is my responsibility to make you understand these things, and then at the end of this we can see how much attainment is there. So objective for this workshop is, the objective of this session is to bring clarity in implementing outcome-based education through deep understanding of educational objectives, program outcome, program-specific outcomes, competencies, performance indicators, and course outcome. So those who are new to this policy that was released by AICT regarding examination reform, and in that case, the two terms which are appearing in this objective, that is competency and performance indicator, may be new. Otherwise, all of us is already been discussed as well, and we are aware of the program educational objective, program outcome. These terms are already known to us, though we will be discussing in later stage, later part of this discussion. And what outcome we have set for this, after completion of this session, the participant will be able to analyze the graduate attributes and the program outcome of an engineering undergraduate program. So that would be the first objective, and that you understand the graduate attributes or program outcome thoroughly, and then analyze those graduate attributes and program outcome. Then only you'll be able to map these things with course outcome or the competency and performance indicator that are on card. Write and analyze the competencies and performance indicators of program outcome, and then finally we write critique of competencies and performance indicator of program outcome. That is what the agenda given by the AACT, that through this we should basically sensitize the participants so that they can go through the document which is released by AACT in 2018, namely examination reform, and the list of the competencies and performance indicators for the program outcomes are given there, and we will be critically reviewing some of the program outcome, and then it will be your turn to review some of the program outcome of your choice. So that is what the objective and outcome of this particular session. So before, I suppose 10 years or so, nobody has heard about outcome based education, what OBE is. And it was, you can say, nowadays everywhere we are talking about OBE. So it is my, you can say, the first of all, we try to introduce you from where this OBE has come, though we'll not go much back into the, you can say, very old history, but we'll discuss this from where this OBE term has come up. International Engineering Alliance, it basically came into existence in 2007, and this particular alliance was covering, because before this there were so many agreements and accords for the OBE as well as for the professional engineers, and then they were at the different levels, and there was no such, you can say, which is there was no common platform where everyone was able to discuss and deliberate the common issues of engineering education and the engineering practitioner. So this International Engineering Alliance, which came into existence in 2007, is umbrella organization for few accords, and I'm sure that most of you have already heard about this term Washington Accord. Here we have written WA. This Washington Accord basically it was related, or it was a collection of six countries' thought process. The six countries came together and they analyzed that their education system, engineering education system, is almost similar in nature. Their accreditation processes are also similar in nature, and that is how basically they reached to a consensus that we can give equal weightage, equal privilege, equal, you can say, whatever incentive we give to each and every engineer who are passing or taking graduation from the signatory countries. So that is how this this everything started. And in Washington Accord, this the everything was, you can say, centered and about the graduate attributes or the capability of an engineer, what he has to do. That we'll be discussing in the next slide. But they thought and they basically implemented this accord, and everything was, you can say, common for all the engineers. And no doubt it is one thing that is also important to mention here that in Washington Accord, only those graduates are considered to get benefit of the Washington Accord who have passed through the accredited colleges. So that is what basically even it means that even if it is IIT pass out or NIT pass out, if it is, the programs are not accredited, then the Washington Accord is not applicable to those. So at present, there are 21 permanent members in this Washington Accord, that permanent signatory, and 7 are the provisional member. And India became permanent member in 2014 after 7 years of provisional membership. And that is rather one of the reasons that this National Board of Accreditation come into existence, because according to Washington Accord, the affiliating, you can say approving body cannot be the accrediting body. So that is why this NBA came as an offshoot of AICT and given the full autonomy. And then only it was able to have, it was able to sign on behalf of India, and then National Board of Accreditation is signatory for India. It means we were given provisional membership in 2001, and it is, I'm happy to share that our membership is extended for 6 years in 2020, because there is otherwise there is no such permanent membership given to the to any country. It is only on the basis of 6 years, and then it is reviewed, and then finally it is thought how, then again it is reviewed and the permanent membership is maintained. Then the different accord that is also part of this International Engineering Alliance, that is SA, that is Sydney Accord in 2001 and Dublin Accord in 2002. India is not signatory of Sydney Accord and the Dublin Accord, but we are trying, the authorities are trying to get the membership of these bodies as well, because Sydney Accord is related with the technologist and the Dublin Accord is related with the technician, that is the polytechnic and this ITI education system are governed by Sydney Accord and the Dublin Accord respectively. And there are some agreements that is there for the practicing engineers, and there are 4 such agreements that come under the umbrella of International Engineering Alliance. And India is a signatory in IPEA, that is International Professional Engineering Agreement, that happens in 1997. And from Indian side, it is Institution of Engineers, which is the signatory for this particular agreement. So, and everything, especially this Washington Accord and Sydney Accord and Dublin Accord, it is largely focused towards, or it is totally focused toward the educational experience that a learner is having in during its course of the study, whereas the other are for professional or practicing engineers. So we are focused only on Washington Accord, Sydney Accord, and Dublin Accord, and the things that we will be discussing here, they are largely derived from those. And rather, we are bound to get, or the, you can say, derive the processes of accreditation and the education. It is binding on us because we are signatory member of Washington Accord. So that is what the global perspective of outcome-based education is. And outcome-based education is applicable to all 3 educational experiences, whether it is undergraduate degree program, or it is technologist program, or it is technician program. So that is the global perspective of outcome-based education is. So we have talked much about outcome-based education, but we did not formally introduce outcome-based education. So this particular slide will depict the philosophy of outcome-based education. It is not new term. It is basically being researched from 1965 or so. There are so many researchers working on the outcome-based education, but and this outcome-based education, as we already introduced, that it is a student-centric approach we have to use, and otherwise for the conventional educational experience of the system, we used to have the teacher-centric approach, that is the objective-based, and now it is outcome-based. And outcome, as we have already discussed, that we have to evaluate the things. We have to basically find how much, to what extent my engineer is ready for the industry. That is what basically we'll be touching upon that aspect as well. So the work by William Spady in 1994 is widely accepted as outcome-based philosophy, and rather under this philosophy, most of the outcome-based education system have evolved. And it is, you can rather focus that it is not from the engineering background, it is Faculty of Education and Art, University of Newcastle, Australia. So that is from where this. And according to William Spady, there are four pillars of outcome-based education. There are four pillars of outcome-based education. And the first pillar says about the clarity of focus. What does it mean? Clarity of focus means that we have to be focused on outcome. What we are going to get once the things are processed. If we take the analogy from the industry, we give some output, we process it, and we get some output. So we have to focus on outcome, the characteristic of outcome, the qualities of this output. So that is what basically we have to focus. And everyone should be clear about those focus or the characteristic or the properties or the attributes of the outcome. So this clarity of focus is the it is at the first or the top of this outcome-based education. And it means that if we are saying we have to have the clarity of the focus, it means we must write these clearly. We should express the course out the program outcome clearly, and we must basically display them clearly so that each and every stakeholder is available of what exactly the learner is to learn from this exercise. The second, we have already discussed, Professor Mantri has also talked about this designing down approach, as we have to focus on the output, and we have to first discuss and describe what my output should look like. And then each and every process from top to bottom has to be designed and aligned and conducted in the same manner. So that is what basically designing down approach is. We start from the focus, we start from the graduate attributes, we start from the program outcome, what exactly is required for my engineer when it is coming out with the degree, and then keeping that into mind, each and every educational experience, each and every educational experience is to be aligned and conducted in the same so that we achieve our final goal. So that is what is the meaning of designing down. The fourth pillar suggested by William Spady is high expectations. And that is where our role came into existence. Because we'll be seeing after one or two slides that as engineer, we always work for some, you can say, complex problem, some innovative problem. We always basically have to address something which never basically happens before, or the solution is not directly available. At the same time, if we want that our engineer should be capable of handling those things, all attributes related to that should be attained by the learner. So what does it mean? It means that unless until we put that higher standard in our education system, in my delivery, in my assessment planning, in my other activities that I intend to do, I cannot basically attain what otherwise is expected from this outcome-based education. So as faculty, our role is very, very vital. We have to show very high standard of teaching, and it teaching doesn't mean it is the educational experience, higher expectations of educational experience, not only the teaching. When we talk about educational experience, it starts from the curriculum design. It includes the teaching learning process, and then it includes finally the assessment that is very, very important. And the last pillar suggested by William Spady is expanded opportunities. I suppose there was one slide in Professor Mantri's presentation when she discussed about the ability of students that are coming into our class. And we also agree, all of us will agree, that the ability of each and every student is different. And there are chances that 5 to 10% of the student of your class may have ability to learn more. So we have to expand the boundary of teaching learning process so that the student who are capable and student those who are willing to explore their potential with the larger or the newer technologies or the knowledge, then we should have arrangement, we should have in the process how that you can say attribute or how that can be extended to the student. So that is what is the meaning of expanded opportunity is. So the outcome-based education is just to quickly summarize, starts from the clarity of focus, designing down, we have to align the processes, each and every processes as per the clarity of focus. And at each stage, we have to find the set of rules which can be easily evaluated. Expectation of the teacher, we have to set a very high standard, and we have to find and plan what we can do for those who want to learn more. Before we proceed further, it is rather, though we'll be having a complete session on Bloom taxonomy tomorrow, but we will be discussing and using the terms which are basics of the Bloom taxonomy level. So I will introduce just the terms of Bloom taxonomy here so that the everything else will be discussed and deliberated in the session that will happen tomorrow. So I'm sure that these levels have already been discussed, and you have already aware of this. At the bottom of this, we have remembering, understanding, and then applying. So these three are the base, at the base of Bloom taxonomy triangle. Most of our education system is assessing, or you can say the teaching learning process is aligned to remembering and understanding. That is what basically is this triangle suggests. And the next level is requiring the previous level, means the understanding. You cannot understand a thing unless until you remember that thing. Similarly, applying, you can only apply a concept if you have understood it better. I'm not going for giving the examples. Everything will be discussed in detail tomorrow. And you can analyze a thing if you are capable of applying to the newer scenario, because we will be applying the things to the different scenario, the concept to the different scenario, and then only we'll be able to analyze once we apply. And if we are able to analyze, then only we'll be able to evaluate. We can analyze many things, and then we'll be evaluating what is the pros and cons of those solutions that an engineer is looking for. And finally, is creating. So that is, these are the six, you can say, Bloom taxonomy level. The first three, we call it as lower order of thinking skills or lower cognitive skills. And the top three, we call it as higher order of thinking skills or higher order cognitive skills. And here it is important to just touch that phase where we are as engineer come through, that is, we will be always being posed by a problem which the solution of which is not directly known. And those problems are complex in nature. And for solving those problems, the top three level, that is creating, evaluating, and analyzing, these should be focused more. But if we go through the question paper that we generally set, it is the first two levels, they are touched upon maximum, then something related with the applying and very little about analyzing. So we have to focus largely on other things. And we know that the first three things we can evaluate or assess using some set examination format and patterns. It's fixed hour examinations and the assignments that we generally give. Though no doubt in assignment, we can rather go one step above also for evaluating, but that depends on how you are designing your assignment, because assignments are, you can say, we can give open-ended type of problem in assignment. So that is why once we are posing an open-ended problem, it automatically, by virtue of the problem itself, it becomes a complex problem. And then if we are getting solution for that open-ended problem in assignment, then it means we can say that assignments can also, you can say, touch that fifth level of Bloom taxonomy, that is evaluating. But the other activities that we perform during the educational experience, that is projects, seminars, case studies, industrial training, and internship. So these are the activities that we generally perform for evaluating, creating, for creating, evaluating, and analyzing, or sometime applying level of Bloom taxonomy. But as far as the outcome or the capability of our engineer is concerned, it is well said, well known to all of us, that the engineers that we produce, they generally, industry says that they are not as employable as it should be. And unless until we change something, unless until we change few things, and we put our best effort, the things would change. And that is why basically this reform policy is shared and put forward by AICTE. And that is what we're basically we are discussing. Also, if we go back about 20, 30 years back, and at that moment of time, when we used to ask employer what exactly they are looking for an engineer, so it was largely 80% of the technical knowledge they were looking for, and the rest of the knowledge, rest of the other attributes were generally ignored. They were not at that time required by industry. But when you ask industry today, it is technical knowledge is only subpart of the skills that industry is looking for. The other parts are equally important. The equal, you can say, weightage industry is giving to technical knowledge and the other skills. So that is how this graduate attributes came into existence. And also, as we have discussed, that the engineers are always exposed to complex problems. So if we are exposed to complex problem, certainly, we have to have skill, knowledge, skill, and the attitude for solving those problems. Because when engineer, either it is working in some organization or otherwise, he has to deal with so many things. He has to deal with the societal issues, because most of the time, the problem that an engineer is dealing with, they are contextual. They are not basically, you are not given in isolation some problem. Generally, they are contextual. And once the problems are contextual, it means you have to go deep into the society, environment, the geographical conditions of that, and these many other things as well. It means the everything is to be, you can say, it has to be, we have to bring together everything, and then the these graduate attributes have been formulated, and these have been formulated around these three red marked words, that is knowledge, skill, and attitude. We can very easily segregate even the program outcome, and we can group them together in knowledge-based outcome, skill-based outcome, and attitude-based outcome. And these are listed in graduate attributes. I once again repeat, we may be using term graduate attributes, we may be using term program outcome or program learning outcome, all have same meaning. Graduate attributes is the internationally accepted term which is given in Washington Accord, and each and every country who is signatory of that Washington Accord has to derive its outcome on the basis of the graduate attribute. So that is what basically is the concept of program outcome, program learning outcome, or graduate attributes. And graduate attributes are generic to the professional engineers in all discipline. But when we write the program outcome for a specific program, we can derive the graduate attributes from the Washington Accord and then align them into the specific program also. And we can add some program specific outcome also, so that these are the things we have discussed as well. Washington Accord is applicable for only UG engineering program, and the accreditation, we all know, it is also program based, because the Washington Accord is also program based. So NBA also accredited the institution on the basis of the program. So basically the programs are accredited, not the institution. And one important thing that is in Washington Accord, only tier one institutions are you can say become or the tier one institutions are part of the Washington Accord. The students graduating from tier one institution, they are part of that Washington Accord facilities. So now coming to the most important phase of this presentation, that is understanding the graduate attributes and what we have to do, how we can align our processes, the educational experience, so that we give at the desired level of the knowledge that a particular student or learner is supposed to have. So that is this particular slide that we'll be discussing. The first graduate attributes is GA1 engineering knowledge. Though we will be using graduate attribute term here, but the explanation, or the, you can say, sorry for interruption, some power issue is there. Yes. Sorry for this interruption, some technical glitch. My presentation went off the screen, so that is why this glitch is there. But mouse earlier. Mouse. So the first graduate attribute or the program outcome is engineering knowledge, and it says that apply the knowledge of mathematics, science, engineering fundamentals, and an engineering specialization for solution of complex engineering problem. Here we can, if we are doing it for mechanical engineering, we can tweak it for the specialization engineering as mechanical engineering as well, for the solution of complex engineering problem. So when this is expected, that this particular PO, it says that we are expecting that our engineer will be able to apply the knowledge of mathematics, science, engineering fundamental, and an engineering specialization. And if we read this statement carefully, we'll be going very slow and maybe repeating the things when we'll be discussing these graduate attributes and program outcome, so that it is very clearly understood what each and every program outcome is. That basically doesn't mean that our this attainment or this level is achieved unless until those are connected. Unless until those are connected to the problem solving attribute. So that is what basically is this particular outcome has to set. And to attain this outcome, what activity we have to perform. So we will be discussing in the same fashion. We will be discussing some characteristic or the keyword of these attributes, and then we will be discussing some of the activities that we can perform for evaluating or assessing the outcome. So for assessing these outcome, the application of knowledge, the examination pattern that we have, that is basically sufficient for evaluating this knowledge, this particular attribute, and we can very easily transmit this everything through the proper dissemination of knowledge and properly designed assessment. No doubt, assessment has to be designed properly, otherwise the things may not happen the way we intend to intend for our intention is. The next graduate attributes or program outcome is problem analysis. So our student should able to identify, formulate research literature, and analyze complex engineering problem, reaching substantiated conclusion using first principle of mathematics, natural science, and engineering science. So there are the keywords in this particular program outcome. It is identify, formulate, research literature, and analyze. So whatever activity we have to do or whatever educational experience we have to share with the student, that is, that should focus about around all these four keywords that are mentioned in this graduate attribute, that is identify, formulate, research literature and analyze what to analyze and all these four activities for what? For one complex engineering problem. And it is not only these things. Finally, we have to close that problem with substantiated conclusions. And those conclusions should not be ad hoc. They should not be intuitive in nature. They should not be on the basis of hit and trial method that we generally use. They should be specifically on the basis of the first principle or the basic concepts of mathematics, sciences, and engineering sciences. So I'm sure that engineering sciences you all appreciate the courses like manufacturing practice, computer programming, fundamental of electrical engineering. So these are the courses, they fall under the category of engineering sciences. So this particular the activities that we have to perform or that we must pose to our student, that should be all these keywords should be there in one activity. I'm sure that you will appreciate in one activity you cannot do each and everything. That is why basically we are later will be discussing, that is why this competencies and performance indicator plays an important role, and that is what is the missing link between this program outcome and the attainment level or the course outcome. So because well, you cannot design one activity addressing to all these, and even if we design one activity and we say that the student has performed well and they have attained that particular activity, it doesn't mean that complete PO is attained. So that is another, you can say, concept that we have to discuss, and that is basically very well addressed by competencies and performance indicator. So that gives us the framework is rather drastically improved using that. The third GA, that is design development of the solution. It is design solutions for complex engineering. Design solution for complex engineering problem and design system components or processes that meet the specified need with appropriate consideration of public health and safety and cultural, societal, and environmental consideration. So we must also able to differentiate between these two outcome, that is graduate attribute or the program outcome 2 and program outcome 3. It says the program outcome 2 is only about the analysis. We are not talking about the whatever solution we have obtained, and that solution will take the physical form or the designing of that is not basically covered in GA 2. So whatever solution we obtained or the conclusions we basically get from the GA 2 or the program outcome 2, those conclusions are to be extended to take the design and development of solutions. So that is why if you read this, this is design development of solutions. Whatever solution we get through the problem analysis or whatever conclusion we get, substantiated conclusion we get from that. So if we take a simple example, suppose simple experience of one particular organization is there that we are facing problem related with the shortage of water, that we have some tank with us, we are supplying the water, but somehow we are not able to manage that you can say requirement or the demand. So it is the experience. So engineer will be told this experience, that this is what basically we are facing, or this is what experience we are having in day-to-day operation of our organization. Then engineer should able to identify the problem from that that statement or that experience, then formulate it and then analyze it, get some solution. The solution may be that you have to add 10,000 liter capacity of this. Then comes the third outcome, the design of it. So first, the second you can say stage is only about substances, substantiated conclusion. We have applied everything, analysis and all that, and then we come up with that conclusion, we need this thing. And in design state, that particular solution will be given the final shape, what to do, what shape of the tank I should provide, or how the things will be regulated, and so on and so forth. And by considering here in the third program outcome, the importance is given more to the appropriate consideration of public health and safety and cultural, societal and environmental consideration. So that is what basically we have to expand the solution or the design into detailed design process. That is what basically a simple formulation of design process is. We design something and we then expand it to the detailed design process, and then the final things, because an engineer, we have to produce a solution or design a product or a service such that it is reproducible, it is economical, it is environmental friendly, it is easy to manage, and so on and so forth. So there are so many things which the design characteristic of any product or a service we can list upon, and that is there in the design philosophy of a product for engineer. So GA4 states that we have to conduct investigations of complex problem. And the description of this GA or PO is use research-based knowledge and research method, including design of experiment, analysis, interpretation of data, and synthesis of the information to provide valid conclusions. The keyword, if you see here, it is research-based knowledge, design of experiments, analysis and interpretation of data, and synthesis, and finally, no doubt, valid conclusions. So we have to design the activities, because in normal courses, we do not have any such activity, or the examination pattern is also not that we have such practices, and we can evaluate, or we can design some activities and evaluate these things through the courses that we are teaching to the student. So if we have to work upon this important graduate attribute or the program outcome, certainly we have to think upon, as the third pillar of outcome-based education comes into picture, that is the higher expectations. It is us who has to think upon what type of activity will be given to the student, to the learner, so that they very well connect to this particular graduate attribute or program outcome, and then they have that attribute, and it is very much required in the industry. So that is the activities that you can do. We can add maybe in any course one of the activities as course outcome, give some seminar in the latest topic, ask them to research, and then you evaluate using the other assessment tools that we'll be discussing in tomorrow's session of assessment planning and rubrics. So that is what basically, it is not only the one exercise, you can have n number of such exercises, but you have to design and include in some course outcome of some courses which you feel it is suitable to add this research-based activity in that course, whether it is not part of the syllabus. Even if something is not part of the syllabus, you are not otherwise supposed to teach this, but certainly you are giving some knowledge, and that knowledge can be connected to the research activity, and all these things can be achieved. Something you can ask them to design your own experiments, you can ask them to have some data taken from some databases which are available on the different websites, and you ask them to interpret data, because nowadays this data science and data plays very, very important role. So data analytics and analysis of data is quite taking front seat, and that is why basically we have to think upon what are those activities and where they can fit into the course outcome. We can have course outcomes, and we can on the basis of the Bloom taxonomy that we'll be discussing tomorrow, because when we are writing outcome, they should follow some action work, and those will be discussed in Bloom taxonomy session. And even if we are not able to connect to some of the you can say course outcome is not able to suffice our process of adding some activity, we can add some activity on the basis of the program outcome, which when we map and identify which outcome is not being mapped properly, adequately, and those outcome we have to fit in some of the courses, so that we can basically assess those students through some innovatively designed activities. Modern tool uses, that is the fifth very important as graduate attributes or the program outcome. The description is our students should be able to create, select, and apply appropriate techniques, resources, and modern engineering and IT tools, including prediction and modeling to complex engineering activities, which with an understanding of its limitations. So that is what it says. So now let us try to find out what are the keywords or what are the important words basically that we can identify to further expand this. The first is create, select, and apply. What we have to create? We have to create appropriate technique, resource. Select. What we have to select? We have to select from from many techniques, many resources and tools, and we have to apply all those things. So it is not only using the tool, merely using the tool in the laboratory doesn't suffice the things which otherwise is expected in this outcome. Our students should be able to create the techniques and the model the resources, and apply as well, and the select as well. So all these three things are important. We largely focus on using or applying, the modern engineering and IT tools, including the prediction and modeling to the complex engineering activities. But generally, we ignore the create, term that is there, and that is important at the first place, that our students should be able to create those tools, those resources. So we have to identify or design some activities related to that as well. And it is very, very important, because nowadays data is in abundance. If we talk about the data which in context to data analytics, if we talk about the things in context to the electronics, then we have number of sensors now coming together, and then their interference and noises has to be removed. And for that, we have to write our own tool, and we may have to use the existing tool as well. So this tool doesn't mean we are only using the IT tools and using some software and then managing the things. Or in mechanical engineering, if we are using AutoCAD, or we are using SolidWorks, or we are using ANSYS software for analysis and all that. So it should not be limited to that. No doubt we should have a perfect understanding of that tool, and if we have perfect understanding, then only we can appropriately select that tool. And understanding limitation is also important, so that we can suggest someone that this tool is appropriate for this activity. The sixth attribute is the engineer and society. The PO number 6, and it says that students should be able to apply reasoning informed by the contextual knowledge. We have used that contextual word to assess societal health, safety, legal, cultural issues, and the consequent responsibilities relevant to the professional engineering practice. I am sure that all of you will agree to this fact that technology is both cause and effect to societal change. If technology changes, it is causing society to change. If there is some change in the society, it is affecting if society is changing, then it is causing technology for newer technology to come. So it means the technology is very well linked with the society. So that is why this GA is here very, 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 you can say, relevant and important. And we should focus, no doubt, too much on this as well. Applying, and if we talk about the important term or the key item, items in this, we can say it is the contextual knowledge, then the societal, health, safety, legal, cultural issues, and then the responsibility relevant to the professional engineering practice. So that is these things, these, you can say, attributes, we can rather, you can say, attain through very well designed the very well designed, especially the, in project work, it is very well, we can design these things very well, and where we can go for the villages near around us, or the we can look around the campus and see what the problems are there as far as this is a small society is concerned, as campus, and then certainly through this we can learn so many things related to the health, safety, and legal, legal thing, cultural issues, and all that. And certainly, it is all related with the problem that is there, and that is no doubt contextual problem solution we are doing. And we are not only basically, it is not that if we apply or solve a problem and pose a solution to the society, if it is posed at one society or implemented at one society, it may not be basically, you can say, very well accepted at other level of society. So that is what basically we have to understand everything so that we can find the solution of the complex engineering problem. So then comes the environmental and sustainability. Now the sustainability is at forefront. We have 17 UN sustainable goal as well, where we, because nowadays it is a fact that we are not giving the solutions which are sustainable. We are the heritage and the natural heritages that we have, the resources that we have, they are depleting very fast, and that is why basically we have to be very concerned, and we have to educate our student or the learner, because the whatever solution we are getting, they are all through the technologist. We as engineer providing some solution. If this, those solutions are not sustainable for decades, or you can say centuries to come, then the society is not going to survive more. That is what basically we have to educate. I'm going slightly fast. So ethics also, basically we can involve our student through different societies, these technical societies. Here ethics doesn't mean that the social ethics, it is one of the attribute, but here the ethics are largely, if you see the description of this, it is apply ethical principle and commit to the professional ethics and responsibility and norms of the engineering practice. So we have many engineering associations. Almost each and every discipline has its association, or rather number of international and national association. And if we involve our student and educate them through their MOUs and the, you can say, the agreement or the laid down procedures, there we have everything listed down. What are the professional ethics? And we should certainly, wherever we have the technical chapters, we should have at least one or two sessions on that. And those can be, you can say, evaluated, and they can be assessed. And so that we ensure that students are getting the professional practice ethics. And that is very important as far as the problem solutions are concerned. Then individual and teamwork, we all know that we have to work whenever the problem, we have to solve any problem, we have to work in team. And that is why the teamwork is very, very important. And individual capability is certainly important. And as we have to go for the multidisciplinary settings. The communication, let me read the description of communication. The communicate, our students should be able to communicate effectively on complex engineering activities with engineering community and with the society at large, such as being able to comprehend and write effective report and design document, make effective presentations, and give and receive clear instructions. So here you can see, you can find the keywords, that is the prepare design document, interact with the society, presentation should be effective, and the instructions should be very, very clear. So these are the things that we have to look upon. So I should emphasize here, if you go through the description and the keywords that are used for describing this goal or program outcome, it is all about the professional, you can say, communication. Merely adding the communication courses doesn't basically suffice that we'll be able to give whatever is required. So we have to add the activities and the, you can say, the assessments in our routine courses, which is basically which will truly evaluate or assess and give those outcome in our graduates. Project management and finance, as we all always talking about the complex engineering problem. And when we talk about complex engineering problem, it means we we have to provide some solution, and that has to be given in specified time. So whenever we are doing any activity in a specified time, it is a project, and we have to manage those project very meticulously. And that is what basically, and the finance also we should discuss. So the activities, project activity that we have in our course curriculum, and their appropriate assessment is important. Merely giving the project and then asking them, you write, you divide it into the component of the activities, and draw the bar chart, or do the scheduling and do the financing, is no doubt important. But more important is to make them aware how they will be assessed, and so that they know what are the component they have to put in for that particular aspect of program outcome. Lifelong learning is rather most important in today's era, where technology is changing day by day. Every day we are getting some news through so many social networking sites that this is new that is coming, this is new that is coming, and old are being obsoleted. So the lifelong, we cannot learn the thing unless until we imbibe something in the students, so that they become curious about the new thing, and they do not feel that they will be not be able to understand because it is new to me, I have not studied that previously. So we have to again identify and put in our course outcome the activities related to lifelong learning as well, because the technology is changing very fast, and the trend will, I suppose, it will remain as it is. So that is what basically is all about. 12 goals. I may have taken a larger time for this, but I thought it is very much essential to discuss the key things, and then only we'll be able to understand the importance of performance indicator and competencies. So if we look at this particular slide, I have divided this complete bunch of 12 graduate attributes in two groups. One is engineering knowledge, another is the first five: engineering knowledge, problem analysis, design development, investigation, and modern tool. And the second one group is all other seven. So we can see from these two groups. For this group, we can clearly identify that first group is about the technical attributes, whereas the second group is about professional attribute. So that is what basically is. If we now see that most of the things that we teach, though when they are playing very little part as far as the graduate attributes or the program outcome are concerned, because through books and the courses that we teach in the classroom, that is from where we get the technical attributes and the professional attributes, the other things, other activities that we have to design and perform. It is not that they are inbuilt in the curriculum. They are inbuilt, but we have to work upon those activities rigorously. That is where this third pillar of outcome-based education comes into picture. So I may be reiterating that, because it is the higher expectations is most important, where our role is there, that we have to design the things. We have to make our student to get whatever is required in the industry. Unless until we do, we'll keep on getting such information or the news that our engineers are not employable, 5%, 10%, 20%, and so. So that is what basically we have to focus to design the things properly. If we see our graduate attributes, that the first five, then we see now, I suppose the slide you must be having this graduate attribute slide. If we see the first five attribute that we have grouped there in that slide, in group number one, dealing with technical attributes, in all those five, this complex word is coming. The complex word is basically intentionally put in all these program outcome and the graduate attributes, because engineer will always be dealing with complex problem. So now we can have a poll. May I request Shivani ma'am to. So in this poll, you have to answer in a course assessment: complex or complicated engineering problem means one and same thing. You have to simply give yes or no. Can we have the result, please? I suppose it was visible to audience. So very nice. We have the result as well, though only about 200%. Result, okay. So 250 participants have responded, and out of it, it says it is same 135 participant and 232 is no, that these two things are not. Thank you, ma'am. Can you remove this poll? So thanks for your responses. That most of us, almost the more than 60% of the respondent agree that the complex and complicated problems are not the same. And certainly it is so. A complex problem can be very easy, but a complicated problem is complicated. A difficult problem, you can say, or the complicated problem, complex problem is not necessarily means that it is very difficult or complicated, because complex problem in engineering education scenario means the unique solution is not available. That is what the first characteristic of complex problem is. And you have to cater to so many things, maybe the different knowledge domain, maybe the different, you can say, professional attributes you have to use. You may have to consider the environment, you may have to consider the sustainability, you may have to consider the ethics, you may have to discuss something to the society persons and all that. So that basically makes the problem complex. It is the chapter end of problem that we generally see at the end of the chapter. There may be some problem which are very, very difficult, but they are not complex, because they are not complex, because in any case, whosoever is going to solve it, they are going to get one solution, unless until it is an open-ended solution, which I generally don't find in any of the book. So whatever, I suppose it is the complex engineering problem is clear. We are aware, we were already aware, but the complex means that we are adding so many attributes to solve this problem. And this particular slide also depicts that we have to work upon many such activities which will be helpful for developing or attaining the program outcome in the graduating engineer. And that is our responsibility, that higher expectation. Now, the graduate attributes that we have discussed in our previous slides. So that we have discussed in our previous slides, that basically came into existence in 1989 in a formal way. But as the technology is changing very fast, and the world is also worried about the sustainable development of society, then these three organizations, that is UNESCO, IEA, that is our International Engineering Association, WFEO, World Federation of Engineering Organization, they created one working group and given the task to look at graduate attributes once again. And then they have proposed some changes, or rather I should not say changes, the changes are very less. I will not be giving you the complete detail of the document that they have presented. Though those who are interested, they can go to the site of AIEagreements.org, and you can go through that document as well. Their complete detail is available, what has been proposed by this group. So they have listed six more, you can say, attributes. But these six more attributes doesn't mean they will add in GA list. GA will remain 12, but they will fit in the description of GA wherever possible. So that is what basically is on card, and certainly that these workshops will also, or the NBA, once it is approved by what this Washington Accord, it will be taken care by the MBA, this NBA as well. So that is this particular picture depicts what exactly is outcome-based education is. And those who are already into some other courses, maybe related to the quality, they can also depict it as a quality circle. And OBE is nothing more than a quality circle. And a quality circle says that you say what you want, means everything you have to list it down. That is what basically program outcome, course outcome, program educational objective, program specific, you can say outcome, and everything you have to list. That is say what you want. And that is basically in our, that is in the curriculum we have to say what we want. And the level of outcome that we generally list in the curriculum, that is at the program level and the course level, we can have the outcome for each and other activities, but in curriculum generally we do not write those outcome of the activities, cultural activities or co-curricular activities, but certainly we can have the defined outcome of each and every activity which we are performing as an educational experience of the learner. And do what you say, that is what basically our delivery is. Again, the high expectations, if we have to attain this goal or the outcome, certainly we have to deliver in the same fashion. And better is the delivery, better will be the outcome, better will be the outcome, more better will be the outcome. So that cycle will keep on repeating, and we will keep on improving our system and our graduates as well. Prove it means assessment. We have to assess here in this quality circle of OBE. This assessment is no doubt is here. It is the assessment of attainment level. So those assessment of attainment level, we will be going through the formal assessment, maybe end semester examination or some other presentations, some project form, some report form, and so on and so forth. So here assessment is largely the assessment of outcome. And once we get the assessment of outcome at course level as well as the program level, we have the different bodies in different institutions. The name of the body may be different. Here I have presented it as Board of Studies, Academic Council, IQAC, Internal Quality and Assurance Cell, and so on and so forth. We may have Senate, we may have Departmental Advisory Board, the name may be different. But certainly we have to have some system in place which will assess the outcome attainment and then will give suggestions to improve it. And the feedback that is there at the top left corner, that is, we also consider the feedback from all stakeholders. So that is what basically the quality circle or the outcome-based education complete framework can be depicted in this manner. So as we already discussed that we have to define the outcome at two levels at least. One is the program level, that is program educational objective that we have to set. And program educational objectives are nothing but these are the, you can say, objective, or these are the, you can the attributes that we want to see that our graduate in 4 to 5 years will be doing, what my graduates will be doing after 4 to 5 years later. It's not precisely 4 to 5 years, maybe even 6 years or 7 years, means they should keep on progressing. So that is what basically we write in program educational objective. Then program outcome, we have discussed in detail. Program specific outcome, sometime it is not possible that everything is covered in PO, then we can add some specific outcome. But still, if we understand the program outcome clearly, or by analyzing each and every term that is there written in the program outcome, I'm sure there is no need for program specific outcome. But no doubt, NBA has suggested that you can have 2 to 4 program specific outcome. Then the next level of outcome is a course outcome where we design the outcome of the course for each and every course, and then we map with the program. And certainly whatever outcome we write, we list, they all should be clearly measurable. As it should not be like that something is written which is not measurable. And that is why if you go through this slide, that is why it is mentioned here that we have to use on the top right corner in this orange box, you have to use the action verbs that again will be discussed tomorrow in tomorrow's session, the Bloom taxonomy. And the other things, we have to clearly set the expectation, that is the clarity of focus at each level, no doubt starting from top, that in the program outcome, then these whenever we are listing the outcome, it should be specific, it should be measurable, we have discussed. And we have to use action verb, and it should be demonstrable. The red thing that is there at the center point of this, whenever we are writing the outcome, we should avoid word like understanding and appreciate, because you cannot observe or measure something somebody is understanding. So understanding can be measured through some action verb like describe, discuss, enlist, reword, and so on and so forth. So that is what basically we should take care of while writing. The main problem, as far as my view is concerned, is in the writing of course outcome. Most of the course outcome, even in the model curriculum that is released by AICT, it is content based. But the course outcome should use action verb, and it should match with Bloom taxonomy. Using the Bloom taxonomy, we should write the course outcome, and then only it will be clear, and the mapping would be much, much easier, and the attainment would be, I'm sure, attainment would be very, very authentic and correct. Okay. So in any case, we have to map to find what is the attainment level of a student, and this mapping happens here. The course outcome we have to list, and program outcome we have to list, and we have to map these two. What is the problem that we have discussed earlier as well? We'll introduce it once again after this slide. And we have some direct and indirect method for the attainment. This is not part of this workshop, the attainment level and how the attainment is going to take place. But this slide was necessary that emphasize that we have to map course outcome and program outcome for calculating the attainment level at program level as well as at course level. So at both the levels, we have to calculate the attainment, how much is the attainment of each and every student, and then only we can improve our methods and produce employable engineers. So competency, so competency and performance indicator, let me once again have this slide, that is engineering knowledge. The description we have already discussed in detail. So I will request Shivani ma'am to please present a poll before you, that will give me an idea, because we have in general 35 to 40 courses in a program. And I want to know from your side that in your program, whichever you are dealing with, how many percentage of courses that can help in attaining engineering knowledge? So 1 minute time is given, so What is the percentage of courses that is dealing with engineering knowledge? His rough idea was required. His poll has ended. So may I request Shivani ma'am to present. No answer is 595. More than 60% is 124. More than up to 60% is 151. So that is what is expected. You can clear this. Only 10% have opted for up to 10%, but otherwise 150 and 120, approximately 275 students exactly. Participants have agreed. That the poll the courses are approximately 60% or more. So it means most of the courses that we are teaching is rather mapping to engineering knowledge. So problem analysis, I have highlighted the keywords that we have already discussed. And I'll request Shivani ma'am to please present this poll. Launch the poll. We have discussed in detail about the program analysis, problem analysis. And let me know from your side how many courses you feel that your program is relating to problem analysis. Can we have the result? Poll time is over. So the shift is towards downside. Almost 153 participants are talking about up to 30% of the courses that are dealing with this, and 206 participants are still feel that we are dealing with the complex engineering problem solution terminology, that is up to 60%. May I request Shivani ma'am to please present the next poll so that we save some time. It is about the design development and the solution, and we all have gone through this design and development attributes. What are the keywords that is there in the description of the design and development? We have to, in problem analysis, we have to identify the problem, formulate and research literature, and in design we have to physically design some component, and let us see how many courses are in your institutions are dealing with this particular program outcome attribute or graduate attribute number 3.
Timer.
Thanks.
All time is over, and we have received very few. You can say up to 30%, so almost similar. Only 61%, 61 participants or respondent has given, that is up to 10% we have in course curriculum. Thank you, Shivani ma'am, for this poll and the result, quick response. So it means what? As we go from top engineering knowledge to the bottom part of this, or towards increasing this program outcome listing, then we find that the number of courses that we are able to map, it is reducing. Though I am happy to see in especially in design and development of the solution, that many were still thinking that there are 30 to 60% of the courses which are dealing with design and development of the solution. If I assume that it is the project and minor and major project and the summer internship are also being counted there. So it means what? It seems like that otherwise our curriculum is, if not, we are not able to map the things, the courses that we are teaching in our program to these 4 or 5 technical attributes, then how we can map the program outcome, how we'll be mapping the courses with the other professional attributes. It will be difficult to find even one or two courses. And as I explained, that it is merely adding the communication skill course or merely adding the human values and ethics doesn't mean that we have achieved that outcome. It is only that we have introduced the basic philosophy of those things, but those has to be mapped with some activity, engineering problem solving activities. That is what basically we should understand while mapping and analyzing. So let us take this PO2 and try to critique what exactly the PO2 is saying, because this would be your home exercise. You have to, you will be given the link of AICT website where this examination reform booklet is there. And in that booklet, program outcome with performance indicator and competencies are given. And we have to, you have to take any program outcome of your choice and you have to give your critical view on that. So that is what basically will be your exercise. And if now let me explain what exactly, how we can do that. So the problem, second PO is problem analysis, the identify, formulate, research literature and analyze complex engineering problem, reaching substantiate conclusion and so on and so forth. And as we have discussed, there are many key points. One, first of all, you have to identify the key points, and those key points has to be converted into the competencies, because we have to have our system in place in such a way that each and every key point is addressed in our assessment and first in our the teaching learning process. So we have taken the key point that and designed the first CA, that is competency that has to be attained. 2.1, we are giving numbering on the basis of the first is the program, and then it is the sequence of that. The demonstrate an ability to identify and formulate complex engineering problem. So we have taken first two keywords from this PO, and then we have identified the competency. And this competency can be assessed through some set of activities that we have to identify. And what are, and through those activities, we have to see the performance of the student. And if those things are there, it means the performance basically, or the attainment of this competency is done. So we have the AICT have proposed the performance indicator for each competency. Let me again repeat. From PO, we have identified the key parameters or the key characteristics. Those we have to convert into the competencies. And for each competency, we have to identify what performance of the student will indicate that this competency is achieved. That is what the meaning of performance indicator is. That the what performance of a student will indicate that this competency is achieved. So the performance indicator listed in AICT booklet is articulate problem statement and identify objective, identify engineering system, variables and parameter to solve the problem. You can see the keywords are coming first, and then the other, we have taken something from the rest of the statement. As in 2.1.2, we can see it is the engineering system, variable and parameter are taken from the rest of the statement. And similarly, for second competency, our student should will be able to demonstrate an ability to formulate solution plan and methodology for engineering problem, and then the performance indicator. So if we go and discuss this particular, give the critical review on this, we can see the identifying and formulate is coming in all these four, you can say, competencies that is listed in AICTE document. So it means that we can, using our own experience and wisdom, we can improvise these competencies so that each and every keyword is equally addressed, not the same thing that is there, ability and formulate, ability to formulate, and then again the ability to formulate and interpret a model, the ability to execute a solution process and analyze the result. So that is what basically you can think upon, because identifying, as I already discussed, identifying, we generally identify a problem from an experience or from a simple statement. And then in formulation, what we do, the identified problem is converted into engineering, you can say, problem. So that is what basically the meaning of formulation is. Once we identify problem, we will formulate. It means we will be using the engineering concept to formulate that problem, and then we will proceed further for analysis using the base first principle. And the second thing which I can suggest here as critique, I'm just giving my critique so that you all are able to understand what basically how we can think to identify the gap in this competencies and performance indicator. It is not necessary one. It is not that you should deliberately try to find out and pinpoint that this should be like this and that. It should be a very valid critical review of these on the basis of what I have suggested. You may have your own, you can say, criteria for identifying the competencies and performance indicator. And the other thing, that if you go through all these four competencies and the performance indicator, nowhere it is appearing that you have to use the basic principle of mathematics, science and engineering science, barring one or two. So for example, if you see 2.2.2, produce and validate result through skillful use of contemporary engineering tools and model. So I think this is a good performance indicator for the modern tool, fifth number of program outcome, rather than this. That is what basically how I look at it. But all of us are well educated and well aware and well versed with all these things. So likewise, when you go one by one, you can identify the competencies and performance indicator, and then you can give the critical reviews on these. So that is what basically the home assignment for you is. We'll be sharing the link of AICTE website where this document is completely available. And in that document, we have all competencies and performance indicator listed. So likewise, we can have the discussion or critical review on the design and development. I can give you one review, my critical review on it, and then you can proceed further. It is basically, let me take the 3.1.1, that is recognized that need analysis is key to good problem definition. As far as my understanding is concerned of design development solution problem analysis, this 3.1.1 to be the part of the problem analysis performance indicator and should be there at that particular, you can say. But still, I say these are my perception on the basis of my knowledge of teaching design courses throughout, you can say, my professional career. But still, if it is part of this, it's fine. So that is how you can identify the performance indicator in all these things. Let me also basically give one particular example how we can plan our activities. We have discussed that the performance indicators and competencies are required so that we can map our question paper or the assessment with the performance indicator, which in turn will map to the course outcome and program outcome, so that finally attainment is feasible. And again, let me again repeat the same sentence that merely satisfying one performance indicator doesn't mean that complete competency is attained, and merely satisfying one competency doesn't mean that we have attained that program outcome. So we have to design a proper target, set of target for the attainment, then only we can evaluate that. That is what basically our engineering student or the graduate are going when they are going into field, they have these competencies and attributes. For example, we have these are again taken from the examination reform policy. I will not be critically reviewing all these, but I am simply giving you an idea how can we design our activities so that we can assess these competencies. As communication, I again repeat, I may have repeated 2-3 times, but I have to repeat again that merely adding the communication skill courses, maybe at 2 level, 3 level, 4 level, whatever level we may add, but it doesn't suffice very much regarding the attainment of the communication, which an engineer should do, because engineering communication is totally different. No doubt that communication, normal communication skills are required, because we'll be using those communication skills that we understand in the classroom to have our engineering communication that we have to have for our engineering problem and while we are discussing with our this. So that is what basically I propose, that we can have reading through case-based quizzes, we can have writing through the abstract of paper and article, listening through audio-video quizzes, speaking through this and chatting, that is the new addition to this communication discussion forum. But certainly these five, you can say, way of communication, they all we are using and all we are doing, we can say we are doing these things. But are we evaluating? Did we document that these things in some course outcome? That is what the important point is. Are we assessing on these things? I'm sure that everyone may be giving some reading exercises, maybe some writing exercise, and all these things should be technical related to your field. It should not be some history exercise that they may do in the communication skill class. But as far as my course is concerned, that basically will help engineers to develop these reading, writing, listening, speaking and chatting in discussion. How to write a discussion form, how to chat or write in a discussion forum. There are so many discussion forum there that is available. And we should have rather in every institution, we should have one, you can say a society or the group or the club that should only focus on the discussion forum and take care of everything. So that is how we can do. So the suggestive activity of all these, we can have the reading. The course I say it is the mobile robotics course that I will be assessing my student for reading in mobile robotics course. That is one example. We can have other courses as well, but certainly if I am using the or I am using this reading skill for mobile robotics course, it means I have to have one CO related with the communication, which is dealing with the communication, and we should add in the assessment as well. Merely writing that we are giving some reading to the student, and then we are basically, it means it is the things are done or assessment, without any assessment or attainment level, it is done. It will not basically serve the purpose of examination reform. We have to document everything if I'm saying that, and this has to be planned in advance through Board of Studies, that the reading communication skill, I have to go through some course and these will be the activities, and that is how. Similarly, writing, we can say it is through the project and widgets. Still, when we, these can also be done through some other courses as well. Then listening, speaking, and chatting. So these are the performance indicator on the rightmost portion, and then the activities are listed in the third column, that is for reading and comprehend research article, writing one page poster presentation, and the activities, you can design your own activities where this, again, this high expectation is very, very important, where we can, we will be able to, we can, we have to design different activities other than the teaching learning methodology, that also we can evolve, because now it is AR, VR have come, the blended learning has come. There are so many things, so many new things that have come up for teaching learning processes. So we can make use of these to have the assessment. So mapping strategy as per AICT, it is program outcome. Then we have competencies to attain. Then assessment and CO. Earlier, there was directly we are mapping CO with PO, the diagram which I have shown in the initial slides, where we are directly mapping PO and CO. And now we have introduced competencies to be attained and performance indicators. And then assessment should map with the performance indicator and performance indicator this to CO. Now, we can expand this because each PO may have different competencies, and different competencies can have n number of performance indicators, and then the assessment should map with the performance indicator. Each assessment question should map with one or two or many performance indicator depending on the type of questions, and then the each assessment question should map with the CO, and that we'll be discussing how that is to be done. We'll be discussing in tomorrow's session, session number 4 on assessment planning and rubrics. So just to summarize what we have discussed, we started with the international or scenario or perspective of outcome-based education. And then we introduced 12 GAs, 9 WK and 7 WP. These are the new terms that I have not discussed. But in Washington Accord, there are 8 knowledge profile that our graduates should have. The 9 I have added here because the newly formed working group has added one more knowledge profile. So now it is in next, you can say, sometime certainly we'll be talking about 9 knowledge profile and 7 problem solving skills that our graduates should do. Everything is listed in Washington core document. And then we discuss in detail about all these 12 program outcomes. We touched about this Bloom taxonomy levels, remembering, understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating, and creating. Then we discussed the mapping and the problem in the mapping, the missing link that was there before mapping course outcome and program outcome, because otherwise it seemed that we do not have any course and activities which can map properly to the program outcome. And we have introduced competencies and performance indicator in this. So that is all from my side. We'll have one quiz. So quiz link is there on chat window. You can open that, click that link. So quiz will open and you have to submit quiz right now. And the assessment, the performance indicator and competencies that you have to submit tomorrow. So we have shared a drive with all the participants, and there you can upload your solution of the home assignment. So let me again repeat, we have shared one link through chat box. One link is for quiz that you have to complete now. Second link is for drive. You have to upload your competencies and performance indicator critical reviews in that drive. So that basically should be done before the start of next session, that is tomorrow. So I assume that by end of today or by 12 night, it will be done. So thank you very much from my side. It is over. And another information I have to share with you, that quiz will be open only till 3 p.m. So you have to respond quiz. I already announced that you have to respond right now. But if by chance you are not able to see the link, or you are not able to open that link, that quiz link will be available till 3 p.m. So I didn't find any questions in chat box, but still, if you have any question, you can write it down and upload with your assignment. Certainly, we'll be happy to share views on that. So thank you very much. Thanks for your patience.